We expect a very exciting interaction with the audience tonight and the panelists, and encourage you to participate and directly confront some of the issues and the questions that are posed tonight. Thank you.
And I'm an associate professor of medicine and medical ethics at Baylor College of Medicine, and coordinated with Courtenay Bruce, our panelist tonight. So ethical dilemmas in health policy is a huge topic. We were asked to sort of focus on end-of-life issues, so that's what we're going to be doing tonight. And today's session is going to be a little bit different than some of the prior sessions, because we're going to we have some cases to share with you, which the people that are in the room actually have the cases there, so you can start thinking about it. We are going to have our panelists introduce themselves and explain why they're at the table tonight and talking about ethics and health policy, and specifically related to end-of-life care policy issues. And again, we're going to talk about local, state, national policies, and some broader ethical concepts. So thank you guys for coming this evening, and I'm going to turn over to Tana.
I'll briefly introduce myself before introducing the other panelists. I'm Courtenay Bruce. I've met several of you, actually. My background is in clinical ethics, so I worked quite a bit in the hospitals mediating disputes, ethical issues, often involving life-sustaining treatment disputes. But I've just recently shifted roles. I'm now much more engaged in hospital operations and business practices within the hospital. So a little bit of a transition in role, but still actually doing a lot of patient communication work, research on patient communication. So now, if Donna doesn't mind introducing herself, and we'll go down the line.
My name's Donna Jakowski. By training, I'm a medical oncologist. I'm board certified in medical oncology and hospice and palliative medicine. I'm a professor at MD Anderson in the Department of Palliative Care, Rehabilitation, and Integrative Medicine. And so in my work, which is primarily clinical, but I also do research and some administrative things. I'm a board member of my professional society, which is the American Academy of Hospice and Palliative Medicine. I help patients and their families decide, you know, with serious medical illness, decide what is the best way for them to live, what makes sense to them. And that takes a lot of communication, as Courtenay was saying. And it's added to by the fact that there's a lot of emotion in these discussions, and people in the same family might be in different places in their thinking. They may be from, you know, we work with people from all over the world, not only with our patients and families, but even amongst ourselves as providers. So really my emphasis is on helping people with that decision making in the larger context of what's going on.
Actually, sorry, I'm going to interject real quickly because I was supposed to say that everyone is speaking for themselves, not necessarily the institutions from which they, where they are, their position, their official position. So we're all speaking for ourselves.
I'm Bill Winslade. I'm a bioethicist at the University of Texas Medical Branch in the Medical Humanities Institute, and I also teach at UT Austin. I approach clinical ethics from philosophy, law, and psychoanalysis.
Arlo Welte. I'm an emergency physician at the UT McGovern School of Medicine and clinically practice emergency medicine both at Memorial Hermann and the Texas Medical Center and LBJ, the sister hospital of Mentab under Harris Health. I do have appointments at the UT School of Nursing as well as involved with the Houston Community College program in EMS. Although I bring a little bit different perspective, I have a current role and had a former role with the American College of Emergency Physicians and a current role with the Texas Medical Association, which is the point that I am speaking entirely for myself because my rule is I am perfectly capable of putting my own foot in my own mouth and I don't like to share it with anybody else. But with that said, part of my framework for this discussion is really this translation of the bedside clinical practice and the academic discipline of ethics into the somewhat awkward sometimes public forum, particularly as it becomes translated into not only medical policies, but that translation of medical policies, which then becomes guiding into legislative action, and sometimes it's listened to and sometimes it's not. But in the larger forum of how many of these issues do affect, if you will, or affect our practice in the public forum.
My name is Ricardo Nuila, and I'm an internal medicine doctor at Baylor College of Medicine, assistant professor, and a hospitalist at Ben Taub Hospital. And I think I'm here because I guess the best way to describe my work is medical journalism. I write stories, articles based on the patients that I see on a daily basis at Ben Taub. And I've written articles specifically about end-of-life care and palliative care. And so that's and what I try to do is take policy, health policy. I'm not a health policy expert, but I try to integrate that into storytelling so that it's something that's accessible for anybody who can read, for the general public.
I'm Savitri Fedson. I am faculty member at the Center for Ethics and Health Policy at Baylor College of Medicine. I'm also a practicing transplant heart failure cardiologist at the VA. So I come to this probably wearing two hats. One is from the ethics health policy standpoint, where I run the ethics consultation service at Baylor St. Luke's and involved in a lot of graduate medical education on ethics and health policy related issues. And then from a clinical standpoint, my patient population are those who have the sort of cardiac equivalent of oncology, in that they're end-stage heart failure. So I have to address issues of the dreaded R word of rationing when it comes to transplant allocation and transplant policies. Before coming here, I was involved in probably the busiest heart transplant program in Illinois. So I've had a lot of experience with trying to navigate systems related to allocation of scarce resources, and then also difficult choices patients and family members have to come with respect to end-of-life care and a terminal disease.
Okay, well, thank you all for your introductions. So, as Joey mentioned, we really want this to be interactive. So at any point, chime in with your questions, comments, thoughts. I'm going to ask you questions that I want to hear from you. I'm going to ask you questions before I ask the panelists. The panelists will almost serve sort of as kind of conclusion thoughts, but we really do want to hear from you. All right, so we're going to open it up with the case. I believe you have the copy right in front of you, and I'm also going to show you on the screen. By the way, can everyone see around me? Am I in the way of this screen, or are you okay? You're good? Okay. All right, so we've already started with what we're going to cover today, which is really state and national policies. We're going to talk a little bit about rationing, cost of care, quality, and access. All right, so we have Mr. Bones here. He's a 65-year-old former CEO of an oil company. He has coronary artery disease, 2 failed kidney transplants, and now has end-stage renal disease requiring chronic dialysis. He's been hospitalized for 2 weeks in the ICU at a private hospital for acute heart failure after another heart attack. He's been unresponsive since admission, so we can't wake him up at all. He remains intubated on mechanical ventilation, can't breathe on his own, seen by neurology, and felt to have an anoxic brain injury, so he hasn't had any oxygen to his brain. He's been developing worsening wounds, decubitus ulcers, and gangrene on his extremities due to poor circulation. So his fingers and toes aren't getting circulation. The ICU team determines that this patient has an irreversible condition and that further aggressive interventions, including chest compressions, shock, and artificial nutrition and hydration, would be medically inappropriate. Okay, just by the case itself, and I recognize we didn't tell you some things, and that's okay. How many people, by a show of hands, think that the appropriate course of action in this case would be? Okay, so here are our different options. I'll read the options first, and then I'd like to see a show of hands. First, the attending physician should write a DNR order for the patient regardless of the patient's wishes or what the family says. B, the medical team should continue treatment for the patient regardless of what the family says. Or C, more information is needed before determining the course of action. So how many people by a show of hands say A? How many people say B? How many people say A or C? Okay, tell me what pieces of information would be important for you to make a determination. Is anyone willing to share? Yes, right here. Oh, let me get the mic to you first.
I would want to know if he had left some sort of instructions while he was in good you know, life state.
Why is that important?
Yeah, I mean, it's his life in mm-hmm. the end.
And we want to honor his wishes.
He has a right to stay what he wants.
Good. There was another hand back here.
They would need the MPOA as well. They need to make sure that the hospital is not going to be liable, and the doctors are not going to be liable in the event that what is done is against the patient's wishes.
Yeah, so making sure we're going to the right family member, the family member that's actually legally in the position to speak on behalf of the patient. Good.
Just medical power of attorney for folks, MPOA.
Thank you. In the back, there was a question or comment.
I'd want to know what his family wants, even if they may not be the designated decision makers, but if there's a... Depending on the dynamics of the group that's going on, you have an opportunity as a provider to either make this a really good experience for them or a horrible like experience to turn into a media fiasco. So it's helpful to have some buy-in from them, at least know where they stand before you start throwing around things they may not understand.
So can I press you on that a little bit?
Sure.
What would you do if the family wanted something different than what maybe he wanted? Either because of what we see on his documentation or maybe the family's willing to admit something we want is different than what he wants. What would you do in that sort of situation?
You need a really good mediator. Have some conversation and discuss why this is important. And at the end of the day, if he says this is not what he wants, ultimately you honor his wishes and incorporate grief counseling, whatever other social supports you need, but you're honoring his life and that was the choice that he made when he was able to do so versus you know, if he's all for this and the family realizes that this is what's going on, you can help him make some peace with that decision of, you know, your dad isn't, it is, your loved one isn't an irreversible state. So
yeah,
it takes some work and it takes a lot of patience to kind of navigate some of these things, but you need more information. Just looking at the chart, it's easy to make decisions, but these are people's lives.
Yeah, I mean, you've got to balance that tension between, you're right, compassion for the family as well as trying to honor patient wishes. And then also throwing in best interest, trying to do right by the patient. So it's a lot of challenges. Any other comments in regards to information you would want to know? Anything else that you think, wow, this would be really important for me in the analysis and they didn't include it? Comments? Okay. Is anyone willing to share what sort of ethical or legal or health policy considerations really jumped out to them in this case? We talked about some of them. We talked about the tension between autonomy and patient wishes. What else?
Just the word regardless mm-hmm. is offensive.
Mm-hmm. Okay. What else jumped out at you? And do you want to explain why? I agree with you. You want to explain why, how it's offensive?
Well, as I said earlier, it's a matter of the patient's wishes and the power of attorney and family. Mm-hmm. It's a very big dynamic, but at no point should a decision ever be made regardless.
Exclusively, yeah. Trying to balance a lot of different considerations. Any other ethical, legal policy considerations jumped out at you that I missed? Okay.
It's not necessarily about that part, but I did notice immediately when it said Mr. Bones, a 65-year-old former CEO mm-hmm. of an oil company, that's going to make news just because of who he was, rather than just somebody down the street, Mr. Jones or something. Because of who he was and what his position was, whatever happens, it's going to hit the news media.
Right.
So that's the first thing that popped out at me.
Very good.
And I didn't like the regardless either.
Yeah.
He's a former CEO of an oil company.
So we got to be careful about how we nuance this. Yeah. Any other comments before I turn it over to the panel? Okay, what jumped out at you guys in terms of different considerations that are at play and maybe intention here?
If the doctors believe it's medically inappropriate to continue the treatment, then they should invoke the law that says that they can take this to the ethics committee of the hospital, make sure that the family is properly represented, and present the situation to the ethics committee. And if the ethics committee agrees with the doctors, then they tell the patient or the patient's representative that they have technically 10 days to either sort of go along with what the doctors want, or they can transfer the patient. And usually, if there's a dispute about this, they could extend the time for making a transfer. Some of you may remember Mrs. Nicolosis, who had a husband in a vegetative state that she was taking care of at home. And when she took him to St. Luke's, they wanted to stop treatment after he went from just being on nutrition and hydration to a respirator. And the doctors there said, no, we don't want to keep doing this. And she had to transfer him to San Antonio, where same thing happened there. But I mean, in this case, it's almost sort of jumps out at you that the advanced directive law specifically applies when the doctors have this opinion.
So there are a lot of physicians at the table, and be curious to hear the reflections on that particular law and when to use it, when not to use it, practicalities.
Well, I think that what jumped up at me is the same thing about the former CEO, because that initially taints this case as being not a medical decision, but a different decision. So I mean, one of the things that I would say is that if you look through the case, it looks, you mean that the ICU team has said that it's medically inappropriate. So I think that futility applies. But what I would be most interested in is also what somebody in the audience said, was how who's had a conversation with the patient or the family before, have end of life discussions been held? Because that's something that is recently been, there's actually been policy about that, to encourage physicians to have more of these discussions. Medicare now allows teams to, either a physician or somebody on the team, to bill for end of life discussions. So I wonder sometimes, you know, reading this case, if this is pre that policy or post that policy, but that's one of the things that would jump out at me about whether or not conversations had been held about end-of-life planning.
Arlo?
Well, I nudged Bill to start off with the Texas Advanced Directive and those laws, which provide not only the ethics consultation, but a very reasonable protection for the physicians involved to do that. So I think that's a very legitimate decision and conversation, although sometimes the question arises, is 10 days enough? But rather than go there, what jumped out at me, because I'm involved with this, was the DNR issue. In Texas today, we have a new law that specifically prohibits the attending physician from writing a DNR order in certain circumstances and creates the circumstances that it is appropriate. But that new law not only does provide some protections, but it also creates a criminal penalty, recognizes an administrative penalty, and a civil penalty for failing to meet the requirements of this new DNR law. And it's being enforced now, presumably, even before the regulations have been written. So the new DNR law we have in Texas at one point is creating a lot of angst among physicians who don't just write DNR orders, at least I don't believe they do, although the basis of this law, the public discussion, if you will, the impetus to pass this law came from kind of the concept of the silent or the failure to notice the DNR order, and where families were surprised. So it's the, if you will, the surprise not being aware of the DNR order at the time that was the angst. So I will personally add my caveat. I don't think this will create a huge necessarily a huge change in practice, but it now has become a recognized area that is fraught with potential problems. So when it is issued, it does need deliberate and due not only thought, but documentation in the record before a DNR order is inserted.
Can doctors write a unilateral DNR order, or do they have to have a consent?
That's an interesting question, in that the attending physician is able to write a DNR order. Now the new law creates explicit circumstances, and it makes the presumption the physician is acting on in the interest of the patient and ideally based upon expressed interest. But it's never quite that simple, at least in the emergency department where there's a clear DNR order or an intent. I mean, it also involves the nursing staff and the other professional staff there, so it's, in a sense, it may be a single attending physician writing the order, but it's not without circumstances from the other professionals there. And I like to say in emergency medicine, no patient I see, I am never the last person to see the patient. Every patient I see is seen by another physician. Even the ones I pronounce dead get seen by the pathologist. But everybody I see gets admitted. So there is an ongoing team. So there is no longer a single physician caring for that patient. So it depends upon, if you will, a continuity of care of other, if you will, attending physicians taking care of that patient.
So let me interject real quick with the law he's referencing, just to give some context for you all. Have you heard about this law that's coming down the pipeline? I'd encourage you to Google it on your off time, because there's just, frankly, a lot of lay media. So for those of you who don't have a lot of legal background, it's turned it into non-legal language, so I think it's easy to read. It's called Senate Bill 11. I have a little bit more skepticism about exactly what it's doing to healthcare providers. I think it's going to change clinical practice for the worse, honestly. That's my opinion. And my opinion, not my institution's opinion. But I've written a few articles on it, so I really do strongly believe that. I also think it maybe didn't follow good health policy standards. Not a lot of buy-in for writing the bill. It was kind of done very quickly and kind of hushed, put into legislative session at last minute. Just really not good. Not backed by a lot of evidence. So it just, it's a good lesson in health policy about how not to write a bill, I think. But I do think there's a little bit of confusion between the institutions on whether we should be following it or not, given that they haven't put out the regulations. My institution has taken a little bit more of a hands-off approach until regulations come out. So this is the chaos that happens when you don't have a well-disseminated and well-written bill, and that is that one. And if you... there's a lot of good lay pieces out there. I think I wrote some articles that I think are pretty lay friendly. So if those of you who are interested in researching more about it, I'd encourage you to do so. But I just wanted to interject with that real quick, just because I thought they might need that context. But I'd like to pick back up on where we were. So sorry about that, guys.
So there are two things, and I think so. I looked at this and I saw that he was a formal CEO, and I don't really care. I actually like to think that I like to know what people do, but I do treat, I think, my patients pretty equally. It does imply, at least in my field, it has ramifications for insurance, and therefore insurance has ramifications for what type of options you have, as far as just medical co-payments for immunosuppression, for example. I wanted a choice D as opposed to A, B, C, or D. Because I don't think when I've certainly written my fair share of DNR orders, but I don't think of it as writing a DNR order. It's having a conversation. And I think what you needed to do is have a conversation and talk about why you think it's medically inappropriate. And I also think part of the understanding of what a DNR order means, and I mean, most of the time people think about sort of end-of-life discussion as being a trach and a peg, and it's not about that. Most of the time, people think about DNR as chest compressions. And what I am, this is maybe my single-handed effort, but, we think of DNR as being CPR, chest compressions and mechanical ventilation. Chest compressions is a medical procedure, and it has medical indications. And medical indications are the lack of spontaneous respiration and circulation in a patient who's not expected to die. That is when CPR is appropriate. If you are dying and you stop breathing and your heart stops pumping, you are dying. You're not having a cardiac arrest. CPR is not a medically indicated procedure. I'm trying to get my colleagues to embrace that again, realizing that it's one of the very few, if not the only, medical procedure that in some ways we are obligated to offer to people, even if it's medically not indicated. But likewise, if someone is a full code or whatever language your institution uses, there's no mandate for how long you have to do it. You have to do it properly. You have to do it for one round, but you could stop after 3 minutes. And that's also something I'm trying to to encourage people to take ownership back within the medical profession, saying if you don't think it's appropriate, if you're having ongoing discussions, he codes, his heart stops, give him one good round, you know, do it properly, and then stop. And that's okay. And that's legally and that's ethically justified.
What should the doctor say to the wife?
What should the doctor say to the wife?
Mm-hmm.
I think the doctor should say to the wife, sort of sit down, ask her what her understanding is. This is a man who sort of at least should have had conversations, I hope, in the past, having had two failed kidneys. We don't know why he failed the kidneys, whether it was bad luck or whether it was bad stewardship of his organ. He's been on dialysis, which we know is something which is life-prolonging. It is not life-saving. People do die sooner on dialysis than not. But it is certainly hinders your lifestyle. So she should have, I hope, have had some savvy. The fact that he was a CA implies at least a certain savviness. And having had two transplants, he's navigated the medical system. But I think to sit down and say, you know, what's happened to your husband is you know, horrible, tragic, whatever the circumstances are. He's coming now. He's got progressive cardiac dysfunction. I'm assuming he's, you know, I don't know whether the ulcer is gangrene or because he's thrown emboli or whether it's just vasoactives and pressors. But to say it looks like his brain is not going to recover. Ask what his quality of life was, what his wishes were. If he's not going to have any cognitive function when he comes back, say, anything we do now is really going to prolong the inevitable. The inevitable is he's dying. I use that word. I think she needs to hear the word. I think we need to figure out if he had any advance directives, had any wishes, and say what we are doing now is causing more harm. If I do chest compressions, it's not going to have any outcome that's positive. It's not going to change the inevitable. And try and have a conversation. It may take her 2 days to come to that. It may take her half an hour. She may never come to it. And in which case, you're stuck in a position of trying to figure out, do you want to invoke TATA? Or do you want to say, you know, his heart stops, fine. If it goes asystole, you document in two leads. You don't have to call a code.
So I want to back
yes,
the follow-up
absolutely.
From here. Because I think we need to look at how we got here. And we're in a state of conflict. And that's not where we need or want to be. So I agree with everybody in the room that we need more information and conversation. And I think there's a time to be directive with people. And again, my own opinions, not MD Anderson's. But we need to sit down not only with the wife, but with all the involved family members and any pertinent clinicians who might have been important in this person's care, other people. People don't, they're not just patients, right? They don't come in isolation. They come in a context of a family, and by family, not necessarily just biological relatives. And sometimes there are biological relatives to be excluded. But you need to sit down with that by the patient's choice, okay? And I just came from a meeting about the Senate Bill 11, so I have to say MD Anderson's opinion is a little bit different. Mm-hmm. And while I think the bill itself is going to make things much more difficult for people, I hope that it will act as an incentive for people to sit down and have these conversations earlier, because despite what you're saying, it wouldn't shock me in my role as a palliative care clinician that there hadn't been discussions with the transplants or the previous MI or things like that. So I think we need to first start and sit down with the family and understand where they are. What do they understand about his medical circumstances? What do they see as his prognosis? What do they see as his quality of life right now? Okay. And what was he like as a person, right?
According to the case, the wife and the daughter from a previous marriage are in conflict already.
Right.
So how do you resolve that?
So you approach it. I wouldn't say resolve it, because sometimes it's resolved and sometimes it isn't. You approach this by sitting down and listening first, and it takes a lot of listening, and you try and focus it on the patient and not on their conflicts with one another, always bringing it back to the patient. So you try through their voices to get to know him as a person, as an individual. You try to align their understanding of what's going on and fill in any medical gaps or misperceptions. You know, when you're talking about something like feeding tubes, that's very emotionally charged.
And so while medically, and I personally take issue with the word medically inappropriate, it might be medically futile, and that's also emotionally laden, it doesn't help. And so we need to help them understand that it doesn't help, and if he aspirates, it might even shorten his life. So I think we want to kind of focus on the big picture things and what's important to him as an individual from their perspectives before we start focusing on interventions.
What if he's never said anything about this?
Then you can try and approach it from conversations he may have had by maybe he's known somebody else in a medical situation, or maybe we've all watched TV, right? He may have seen somebody on ER or some other show or commented on somebody that was in the news, because if at all possible, we don't want to have to get to the Texas Advance Directive Act. If we can avoid it, it would be better. Because I think then the family is left with all this conflict, which just adds to their burden of distress. So I think it's a necessary tool, but I think it's one we want to try and avoid if at all possible.
So real quick, because I want to encourage a little bit more interaction from the group, how many of you, by a show of hands, have ever personally been involved in a case like this where you had a family member who was at the end of life and there might have been some discrepancy between family members as to what to do? Okay. What would you have liked in terms of how healthcare professionals would approach you or your family? Did they do it right? Did they do it wrong? What stuck out to you as being good or bad in the experience? Anybody willing to share? I know it's personal, but I think we learn a lot from your personal experiences. And we talked about a lot of different approaches here. One approach was you got to sit down with the family and you need to learn who the different players are, figure out a little bit more about his wishes, try to figure out where they're at, and try to really help mediate the situation. We learned some people would take a little bit more of an adversarial position, which is going through the Texas Advance Directive Act and moving along even unilaterally. And then we heard a little bit of a combination of both of those approaches. So there's really a continuum, I think, in the way we could approach families. So what's better? Yes.
This was my in-laws' family, and so I kind of heard down the grapevine a little bit about what happened medically with the family and providers, but I would have liked for the providers to be more transparent about our family member's condition and to use the words death and dying, because there was a lot of dancing around those hard words, and I understand that they're hard, but that also creates a lot of confusion within the family, and it makes it a lot more difficult to understand what kind of choices we have and what kind of choices we're actively making about our own family member.
Very nice. Couldn't have said it better. Any other experiential points we should draw from?
I unfortunately have had the opportunity of four different family members.
Oh, dear.
And one being the best of all possible worlds and the one, I think, the worst. And so it's different with every family member, even within the same family. My daughter, who was only 29, was an attorney. She was well-educated. She was employed. The key for her, she did not have advanced directive. She had fourth stage ovarian cancer. And she knew she was dying, but never did any advance directives. She knows where it was going. Her physician at that time let her come to the decision. He was getting, you know, are you going, you know, we've done everything sort of talk. And she said, so what else are we going to do? He let her dictate her care. She said, I want this NG tube out. I want to start TPN. I haven't started GEMSAR yet. I want to do this. And he just said, okay. He gave her 4 days for washout period. He said, okay, we've done everything you've asked us to do. Do you feel ready to start a new chemo tomorrow? And she said no and went on to hospice care. He let her come to that. 4 days didn't make any difference in the trajectory of her care. So that was a very good experience. He let her come to that. My niece, on the other hand, who I was an MPOA for, was in her 50s. She was on a ventilator for COPD. She specifically said, I do not want to be here. I don't want to be on a ventilator. So her daughter and I made the decision, get her off, you know, just take her off. The physician who was on call, the hospitalist, said, he actually grabbed her. This is probably, I've been a nurse for 40 years. I've never been traumatized this way. He grabbed her arm on a ventilator, medicated, and said, "Do you want to die? Do you want to die?" A screaming in her face. We took her off the ventilator that Monday. She lived 2 more years. you know, so I feel like I've experienced both ends of the spectrum.
I don't even, I don't know what to say in response other than I really appreciate you sharing it, and I'm so sorry you had to experience that, but I have to tell you, you're not alone. I've seen quite a few physicians do the, do you want to live, do you want to die, I'll resist comment on that.
I will share an experience I had just from a little bit of a different perspective as a nurse that was taking care of a patient. So I was taking care of a patient that had the unfortunate diagnosis of a glioblastoma, so most likely very terminal. Mm-hmm. And as she was nearing the end of life, it seemed that her spouse was not able to really come to grips with what was happening and sort of had this false sense of, like, that she's going to somehow come out of this and that she's, you know, she's on a ventilator, she's on artificial nutrition, she's not responding to anything. And we're coming to the point where, much like this case, she's becoming gangrenous due to pressors and whatever mm-hmm. other interventions we've been doing. Right. So, you know, not in a great place and just obviously not pleasant for that patient either. I can't really imagine that was a good death for her. But we had the same situation where, you know, two family members, the daughter was really angry with the father that he wouldn't let her go and wouldn't let her just discontinue the care. And they ended up going into the Futility Act and having to enable that. And anyway, it was a big mess. And I think from a health professional standpoint, it was really hard for us to watch, you know, as the people that were taking care of her every single day. Because as nurses, you know, we want to do what's absolutely the best for the patient, just like any other health professional. And it's hard to watch that family dynamic and also still know that what you're doing in your job during your shift is not really what's best for that patient, and it's hard. And I wish that in knowing that this patient had this diagnosis, I mean, maybe she got the diagnosis 6 months or a year before, that physician had a realistic conversation with her about, this is the prognosis, here's what's going to happen, and it's not likely you're going to live another mm-hmm. 5 years or even maybe another 2 years. So let's start talking about that now and while you're still of sound mind. And maybe the turnout would have been totally different. Maybe that we wouldn't have had to get into ethics cases with the hospital, and we wouldn't have had to go down that, you know, Futility Act road and get involved with this. And Lord knows we ended up with threats against our ICU and the husband being very aggressive toward us, threatening to bring a gun into the hospital if we didn't, you know, comply with what he was asking of us. And it was a very heated thing. It was very difficult to watch and deal with for all of us. So I don't know if that was anything helpful, but.
No, well, I appreciate that.
Can I follow up on one of the comments, though? Because we have heard the conversations with family and making sure that the individual and advanced directives, but I think one of the things that we oftentimes do leave out, and thanks to your question, you know, yes, somebody needs to be in charge of the healthcare team, but the idea of one doctor, one patient, and that's all that's involved, you know, that's a model that's long since gone. This is a very much, particularly in our high-intensity hospitals, this is very much a collaborative practice and a team approach, and I think making sure, for some of the reasons you just mentioned, that the nurses are independently licensed and have a professional responsibility and are very involved with that care. Many times you'll have advanced practice providers, nurse practitioners, physicians, assistants involved and responsible going on. You have consultants that are very much going on, and many of these, even though they're not making necessarily the primary decision, you know, regarding the patient, they are all participants in the care of that patient, and I think we need to recognize, particularly the nursing staff, that's there 24 hours a day with these individuals.
Joey?
And I, I
since this is a policy course, and we're specifically talking about ethics and how ethics influences policy, I mean, what I'm hearing, I think I'm hearing everyone talk about is really that the conflict between autonomy, patient autonomy, and best interests, which sometimes there's a conflict, and then how does policy roll out to, how do you balance those things when you create a policy? And at the state level, and I guess a question stemming from that is, do all states feel the same way about that balance between autonomy and best interests of the patient? Like, who decides? Like, does the clinical team decide on the best interests, or does the patient have ultimate autonomy, and whoever is the surrogate decision maker, if the patient's not able to decide, do they have it? So show of hands here, do all states feel the same way about that balance? Yeah, no, so it's different. So even though we're talking about health policy, and with the Texas Advanced Directive Act has been brought up a number of times, that's the TADA acronym, we're different. It Texas in many ways for many things, but that's just one policy.
Well, I think one thing that also, and this ties into not only health policy, but also with ethics, is that the way sort of medicine has been practiced in this country historically, and actually Senate Bill 11 is going to challenge that, is that we allow patients who have decision-making capacity to make poor decisions. We allow them to make poor decisions for themselves. Hopefully it's an informed decision, you engage in shared decision-making, all of these things, but people can make poor decisions. It's not quite certain whether or not we give surrogate decision-makers the same latitude. And so it's very different when you're talking about surrogate decision makers, because that's if you don't have substituted judgment to act on and then you're acting on best interest, that's when physicians and the best interest could come in play. Because as a physician, if I think what might be in the best interest of for someone, but they don't believe it to be the case for them, I'm going to defer to their autonomy if they have decision-making capacity. I might try and persuade them, nudge them, however. So I think that's one thing that's a little bit different. And the way Senate Bill and Courtenay, please, or people who have read the legalese of the policy more than I, or have understood it better, one of the concerns that's come up with Senate Bill 11, which is supposed to take effect April 1st, so that's this Sunday, there has not been rulemaking, but there is a clause in it that gives surrogates the power to overturn a DNR order that has been witnessed. So it's absolutely fabulous. 60% of people die from chronic diseases, and yes, they ideally should have had conversations with their caregivers. But you have to, more importantly, maybe have discussions with the people who are going to be your surrogate decision makers, because they could overturn your decision based on Senate Bill 11.
Most hospitals have policies before this that require somebody with authority to consent. And there's a big dispute between physicians who think there should be unilateral DNR orders and those who recognize that having the policy, mm-hmm. you have to go through that process. And I think you put it well in saying that you only should do codes when it's according to the policy for codes, not just do, you know, resuscitation regardless of the circumstances. Mm-hmm. And that's hard for people to understand. I mean, they've seen too many episodes of medical TV.
Well, they now have to put out public service announcements to say that if you have a systole or a flatline, that you don't have to get shocked for it because it's a non-shockable rhythm.
So actually well established that the success rate of CPR and TV is about 79 or 80%, which is in distinct contrast to what it is in real life. But I would also argue that while people have the right to make poor decisions, the onus is on us to offer medically appropriate treatment interventions. And so thinking of some of the comments in this room, sometimes clinicians offer treatment options that aren't realistic or appropriate. So I think we need to think about that. Now, CPR, I agree personally that we shouldn't offer it to people for whom it's highly unlikely to be successful, but I think culturally in this country, that's not where we are today. So right now the default is CPR, and that's where it goes back to earlier discussions and using language that people can understand. So if you are in the moments of dying and everything we've done to help you live longer isn't working anymore, this isn't going to help bring you back to life. It almost never brings a person back to life, so that the person understands that you're talking about bringing somebody back from the dead, as you were saying. And often using words in a way that people can hear helps them come to that decision and not feel like they're giving up.
Were you going to add something?
Just one thing for those people who are at a bedside in whatever sort of role for healthcare providers. One of the things that, at least linguistically, which has helped is if someone is on vasoactive drugs and high dose pressors, that is the equivalent of a medical code. You just aren't doing the chest compressions. And sometimes when you explain that to family members, saying, you know, for the last 3 days, they've been essentially getting a high dose code continuously for the last three days. No other medical intervention, no other, you know, push of epi or vasopressin is going to do anything more than they're getting right now. That sometimes really helps bring it home to family members in sort of the acuity, that just from a at the bedside, what can help get that point across to family members.
So we've talked a lot about several different ethical considerations. You heard the word autonomy come up. You heard the word best interest come up. One principle that we didn't talk about, which has a heavy, heavy role in health policy, is justice. So to what extent, I'm going to ask them first, and I'll turn to you guys. To what extent do you think justice, or even let's go so far as to say rationing, what extent do you think it should play in this sort of case? We didn't mention anything about his resources, or did we? Did we say he's what?
He's at a private hospital.
Okay, he's at a private hospital, so he's got some resources. Insurance. Let's suppose he didn't. Should that at all enter the calculation? And to what extent? What do you think? No one's willing to share? Yes.
My name is Nikki. I'm a first-year MD-MPH student at McGovern. I think it shouldn't, but it does. I feel like you can't talk about justice without talking about the percentage of people who are uninsured and underinsured in our nation. And sickness and illness does this thing where it strips you of every other part of your identity, right? So whether you're a CEO or a janitor, it doesn't matter when you're sick and when you're in the hospital. And that's the beauty of medicine. But when business and ethics and everything also plays a role, it gets really complicated. And I feel like he, because he's a former CEO, probably has good insurance at a private hospital. I don't know how ethics, I have no experience yet, but the ethics committee will look at it. I don't know if that's a factor or if it's blind, like if they see what kind of insurance the patient has or not, and whether that does play a role in their decision. Because if you're not insured, like, hospitals have to eat that cost, right, of like whatever treatment that they do. And so the administrators and the people who are on the accounting side of that will probably not want to do that if they're not going to be reimbursed by insurance. Mm-hmm. So I don't know, but I'm looking forward to hearing what you guys have to say.
So what do you guys have to say? Does it play a role, and to what extent in the decision making, whether it be at the bedside or through the ethics committee or the long stay committee? What does it play at all into your?
I think that when there are resources, it ups the ante on the decision made by the doctors, because I think that in this case, the doctors have deemed it medically inappropriate. I think that the path of inertia is just to not have the courage to say, you know, this is medically inappropriate, we need to stop. I think that it's easier to not stop when you have resources and when you can continue to bill an insurance. And so, you know, my perspective is one of where, you know, safety net hospital, But it's not a, but I've also seen the situation in third world countries, and so we're not, you know, at a safety net hospital in the United States, we shouldn't think of ourselves as like the extreme at the other side, right? There's a lot of resources available. But I think, so I think that you, it's you still always have to make a decision with courage of, you know, am I gonna continue, am I gonna have this discussion and say what I think is medically inappropriate here. You don't have to use that term. I'm not, I'm just, that's just the thought, but.
Well, as a hospitalist, what would you do in this case?
As a hospitalist, I would speak very bluntly with the family. I think transparent, I think part of my job is to be able to communicate well with patients and so in families, and I would say, this is, you know, are you concerned that he's losing his dignity? Are you concerned that this is, that, you know, that he's worsening like this? I would tell them that I feel like it's inappropriate. And I would probably, if that's the case, if they really were pushing it, I would probably go toward the path of futility. But but make no mistake, that puts a lot of hours more on your day than just being like, okay, we're just going to continue. I mean, it's actually kind of easy to keep patients on press. It's hard to go and have these discussions. And I think that that's where I think that we need to look at all of our medical professionals and nurses, doctors, and how much of us have the courage to really do all of this. And we need to have more, we need to find more courage in order to do these in these situations.
So part of it when it comes to rationing and allocation, I mean, that's a rationing of time. I mean, so if you think about it, that's also a sort of valuable, fairly scarce resource sometimes at the hospital. But when, I mean, we hate the rationing word, we do it all the time. We don't think of it in terms of that, but antibiotic sort of stewardship and governance of, you know, having ID have to approve certain antibiotics, that's a form of rationing of a particular antibiotic. We do that all the time. We accept it. We don't call it rationing. Therefore, it's not considered sort of this horrible thing that we don't want to do in this country. Organ transplantation absolutely is a rationing process. We take people who we think will do well. You have to be either non-insured, in which case you're eligible for public aid, depending on the state you're in, or have insurance. If you're the underinsured, you can't, so it's either two extremes. But we ration it. We accept it. And socially, it's accepted because people realize it's a scarce resource. So I think that we have to also realize when we think about policy, about rationing, and I think hospitals have created policies in terms of what to do in mass casualty, mass evacuations, triages, the Ebola epidemic when there's a bad, you know, anticipated influenza outbreak. How are you going to triage your 10 ECMO machines? How are you going to triage your CVVH machines in the hospital? We have systems set up to do that where you basically take, you know, best chance of survival. In those cases, insurance hopefully doesn't play a role. I think we would be foolish to say that no, we probably get calls from our administrators earlier if it's going to be a charity case, public aid case, than if it's someone who's got good coverage. I think all of us have had those phone conversations. It depends, probably even more so if it's, and we aren't even going to get into this, but if it's an international patient, because they pay cash. Mm-hmm. They pay cash for charges. They don't even pay percentage. So that's a different level. But that's one reason why a lot of the transplant policies have limited the amount of non-U.S. residents that a program can have to 5%, is to help decrease sort of some of the transplant tourism, and also because it can be a very lucrative business. I think rationing you have to think about in terms of appropriateness. So if you think about, for me, for advanced heart failure and all the mechanical options I could put in someone...
I'm actually going to interrupt you only because I think you're hitting on so many points that we should probably talk about in case two.
Okay.
Especially given that you're a transplant expert, and this case is riddled with transplant and insurance issues and rationing. And so I wanted to kind of segue into rationing, but we were getting too far into it. So okay. I'll pick up right with you. I did want to, before closing case one, I want to add a little bit of a caution for the audience. You heard a lot of stuff from us about Senate Bill 11.
it's a lot of speculation on our part. We don't really know what it's gonna look like in the way of implementation, because we have not seen the rulemaking. So I think there's a little bit of some opinions that came through, a little bit of interpretation that came through, that we could be wrong, really, just because even though there are lots of experts here and everyone's, and there's some lawyers, some health policy experts, I think what we had to say was well-informed. But it's a little bit of speculation on our part as well, just because we don't really know for sure. Yes.
Can I ask a question that nobody's ever answered for me, which is, if the patient has said under the advance directive law that they want everything done to keep them alive as long as possible, and the doctors think it's medically inappropriate, which law should we give, you know, how do we weigh the advance directive law against the other part of the advance directive law, the medical inappropriateness?
What do you think we should do?
I mean, I think it's a really tough question, because if this CEO had an advance directive that said he wanted everything done, mm-hmm. and he knew that coming in, and the hospital knew that coming in, it seems to me to be, if you're going to override the person's autonomy, mm-hmm. then you have to have a pretty good argument for doing it. I mean, the advance directive law supposedly was set it up so that you could have your preferences respected.
Does that then fall back on the definition of alive?
Do everything you can possibly do to keep me alive.
I mean, I'm not sure what that meant myself. I mean, I'm telling you what the law says. What should we do?
Well, my thought is that there's a difference between saving a life and preventing a death. And if you get to the point where you say, in all honesty, all we're doing is delaying the death, then it's appropriate to withdraw medical support. But if you're saving a life, that mm-hmm. doing something positive, well, then you can argue you follow his directives, his wishes. You do everything you can. If you really think you could
save. Sometimes people who are on the brink of death recover unexpectedly. I mean.
As have I. But that happens. I was in practice for 40 years. That happens like twice. And I'm not going to have my entire career influenced by two mm-hmm. miracles. I've got to go by what is reasonable. Mm-hmm. That's the way I look at mm-hmm. it.
I think part of what that also has to appeal to is what we as medical professionals have to do. I mean, we have obligations to maintain our competency, maintain the public trust, to be fiduciaries for our patients, but also to act with professional responsibility. And I think that in if we want to take this case in hand, so he's already on life-sustaining treatment with respect to renal replacement, he's already on life-sustaining treatment with respect to ventilation. So he is getting what the advance directives, if you said if he's heart stopped, there's absolutely no indication to put him on a ventricular assist device, which would be life-sustaining treatment for his heart. You could hook him up to a thumper, which is a manual CPR machine, to give him continuous CPR if his heart stops. But that's not life-sustaining treatment. Therefore, to say that you are not going to do those things would not be necessarily, I mean, maybe I'm sort of splitting hairs, but it would not be violating anything with respect to life-sustaining treatment, because those are not life-sustaining therapeutics.
Moving on to second two. I'll pick up case two. I'll pick up with you, Savi, just like I promised. We have Mr. Sanchez here. He's a 36-year-old male. He's self-employed, handyman. He's hospitalized with acute liver failure, and the medical team has determined that his only options are palliative care or comfort care measures or a transplant. Boy, okay. Transplant, about as aggressive could be. Or comfort care measures, so very dichotomous options. So
when I use the term comfort care, everyone okay with where I'm basically stopping the more aggressive measures and shifting to just pain and symptom control. He has no insurance, and he's hospitalized at the public hospital. So we have a big change in facts, different background, different hospital. The county hospital does not offer any transplants in its schedule of benefits. Okay, Savi, the transplant expert. Actually, before I turn it over to you, I'm going to ask the audience one more question. All right. Do we care at all about his cause of liver failure? Okay, I got a lot of yeses. Is anyone willing to share why that might play a role in their decision as to whether to pursue transplant versus comfort care measures?
The obvious would be, how is he going to treat the liver that he gets, if he gets one? Is he going to be a good steward of that liver?
Can you explain how he might be a good or not so good steward of the liver?
Well, say for example, that gentleman is an alcoholic and chooses to continue his drinking and doesn't treat that liver very nicely. One would say he's just wasted the liver that he got.
Okay.
That's my thought. The first thought, I don't know. There could be more to that.
Okay. And I got a lot of yeses, so a lot of people in that same camp. Can you tell me a little bit about your thought process?
So it would depend on if he had quit for, usually it's 6 months, and what his MELD score was. And if he lived in a state like Massachusetts, you might be eligible for a liver transplant, and so that he would not be at the county hospital without insurance, because in Massachusetts, then you would be eligible for a transplant if you had met those requirements and also if you had a good support system. So all of those things would have to be weighed and taken into consideration.
Can you briefly explain why Massachusetts is different than Texas?
Because their insurance under Mitt Romney changed, and it just, in fact, I absolutely knew a case where if it had happened the year before, that patient would not have gotten the liver transplant. And a year later, with a $40 a month insurance policy, was eligible for a liver transplant when a person in another state, in the Philadelphia, that was a biomedical researcher, was not able to get the transplant because of match. That was not available. So one lived who you might say was not the best candidate lifestyle-wise to have the transplant, and then the one that had really contributed to society did not get the transplant because the liver was not available. So again, the whole rationing and the justice comes in to those comments.
Wow, we've been packed with some statements coming out of you guys. Contributed to society, geographic disparities or equity concerns, whether a person did something using their own behavior. Could you guys unpack that for us?
Oh, where can I start? So I think the first is to assume that there's equity in transplantation is a myth. So I think let's just realize that depending on where you live, depending on what your insurance coverage is, if you have heart failure, your Medicaid in Arizona, it doesn't cover heart transplants, okay? If you live in Montana, you're probably 8 hours to 10 hours from the nearest heart transplant. You aren't going to survive it if you get called, you just timing-wise. So it's a myth in this country that it's available for everyone. So I'm going to unpack two parts of this, and then I'll be quiet, maybe. So part of it is what you said about, you know, the relative social sort of value of a person. I'm paraphrasing you, and I don't mean to dismiss it. Transplant, the way organ transplants have been allocated in this country really is trying not to make the determination of social worth. Because if you take Mr. Bones, you know, former CEO has done lots of good things, and you take, let's say, a single mother with three kids on Medicaid, who is more valuable? Depends who you ask. To her three kids, that woman is the most valuable person. And part of our role as sort of physician advocates for our patients
and even the way we allocate is to look at, are they, do they have the resources? Absolutely. Do they have the resources as far as paying for the immunosuppression, which in the absence of insurance coverage, the anti-infectious immunosuppression can run $11,000 a month for the first 6 months. Not exactly chump change, nothing that I know people can afford. So yes, you have to have resources, but transplant allocation has really not looked at what people do beyond behaviors that will harm the organs. So active drug use, active smoking, these types of behaviors. People certainly who have more resources can get on multiple lists in different cities. Certainly we know very famous people who have been able to have the resources to get listed. That is available to people irrespective of income if you could get to those places. So people living in northern Illinois could get listed sort of in the region around Milwaukee as well as the region around Chicago, even over down into Indianapolis and some over into Michigan, because it's all right there. They could sort of fill into those pools. So there's an ability to do that. But organ allocation has really tried not to put any relative value of social worth, with the exception of pediatrics. So pediatric patients are assumed to have priority over adults for the concept of fair innings. They haven't sort of lived the number of years that they might otherwise be sort of socially expected to live up until you're 18. After 18, you're treated like any other adult. But up until the age of 18, you have priority for organs. That's about the most that organ allocation is willing to sort of render as far as social worth.
So just to clarify, the social support was intended to show that post-transplant.
Oh, no, absolutely. He could take care of
that. That there would be a network
absolutely.
To support that. That's what I have meant by that.
And actually, as an aside, that is one consideration, the support system around a patient, regardless of wealth or regardless of anything else, really. Has been highly, highly linked to a person's post-operative outcomes in terms of their mortality and morbidity. With the people who live close to you and support you, and the better that support system, the better you're going to do from an adherence standpoint and just from a recovery standpoint. So we really try to pry into people's their support system, and that's not really all that linked to wealth, which is nice.
And interestingly enough, also in the liver transplant field, the presumption that alcoholic cirrhosis is that you need 6 weeks of sobriety before all that, 6 months of sobriety before that, is being challenged and being studied. In fact, they found that in these studies that it's not as indicative of failure of that organ as they would have thought before. So that's even challenging our society's presumptions about illness, right? Because it's also, then we start thinking about, well, we are conceiving of alcoholism as an illness, and somebody happens to have one illness and they can't get a transplant versus another illness. But even if somebody is an alcoholic, right now in the liver transplant field, that is still being studied and determined that it's not as predictive as it would have, as we would have all thought of. And it's revealing how much we have in our socially or in our social conscience, how much we think, consciousness, how much we think about alcoholism as predictive, that people are not going to use that organ well.
Controlled in any other way. Like, I like to think about, like the positives rather than, he was probably what if it was something that was literally out of his control? Like, would that make any difference?
So I think that's really interesting in liver transplant, because actually the way that this happens, which is not necessarily the case, this case that we're talking about, but a liver transplant center has a group of that sort of comes together, and then they look at all this medical data and they try to make it as numerical as possible, but then they can assign extra points on in order so that person to kind of rank the patients as to what's to rank patients so that they can get where they rank on the list. And those extra points sometimes can take into account, like, oh, well, this person has a genetic thing. Let's give them extra points. Those are called allocation points. So it could be something that the board, like the transplant board, when they see the patient in the individual transplant centers, decide, oh, this is something that moves us enough that we want to give this person extra points.
Although partially it's because you wouldn't expect them to get a high enough MELD on the acuity of their liver disease. So some of it has to do with other physiologic factors. I mean, other organ allocation. So, I mean, we always think about, if you think about heart failure and you think about people getting, a heart versus not, and I would actually argue, so palliative care and LVAD is palliative care for end-stage heart failure. So, you know, if you think about someone with bad heart failure, you could get a transplant and LVAD. They're both very, very aggressive things. LVAD is palliative care, as is home inotropes, as is, you know, medical management, as is home morphine and oxygen. I mean, the spectrum is vast. But I think we often think about disease is like, did you do it to yourself? You know, so we think of people who get cancer and who get maybe a heart failure related to chemotherapy. Oh, that's really sad. They got cancer. They didn't mean to. Versus someone who smoked and drank, or you know, oh, part of it, they did it to themselves. You know, they ate poorly. They smoked. They got coronary disease, and we don't think about the fact that everyone in their family died in their 40s. And yeah, they may have smoked a little bit, but everyone died in their 40s, and it was inevitable. So I think you're absolutely right in saying that there's a lot of social stigma, unconscious or sort of just subconscious, that we value certain disease states and not. I think it's interesting with liver transplant. It's one of the situations, if you take a Tylenol overdose and come in with a fulminant hepatic failure, you've tried to kill yourself, we'll consider you for transplant. That's still I have problems with, and I've been in transplant 20 years, that I have a hard time thinking that we will transplant someone who's just tried to kill themselves, because generally speaking, we expect people to have self-preservation thoughts when we're going to give them an organ. That still I battle with myself on that one.
Yeah, so as someone who's worked on a lot of medical review boards or patient selection committees where you determine who's getting an organ or not, and I also worked on the ethics committee for UNOS, for the United Network of Organ Sharing. I think we try really hard not to allow biases or stigmas or social considerations to enter the calculation. At least my perspective is you have to have the evidence to back up the determination you're making, that there's somehow some reason that this person is not going to do well from an empirical, statistical perspective, not from judgment considerations. But I think it's really naive for us to say that we can totally strip ourselves of that, because we're human and we make determinations about people based a little bit on judgment. So that's just something we always strive for, more and more data to support our.
And the interesting thing is that the more numerical that it tries to become, the more that people realize they can try to game the system. Mm-hmm. Because then if you and your committee are very numerical and we're not going to be moved with our patient by social factors and it's pure MELD score and pure numbers, well, what they've found is that in different parts of the country, people realize that and they do jack up their score. Mm-hmm. And they get more of the transplants. They get more of the livers allocated to them. So it's a really difficult situation about trying to be as numerical and as, you know, objective as possible to determine who's going to get the liver or this organ.
So sometimes the rules that UNOS has had are stupid, like the child, the age limit.
Yeah.
And then I was involved with this girl that was 10, but she had to be 12 to get the transplant, but she was big. And she was a good candidate, and the parents actually went to court and overturned the UNOS rule, because age isn't the criterion, it's whether or not somebody's a good candidate for the transplant. So you have to look at all of these sorts of things. And sometimes gaming the system and multiple listings and all the kinds of things that people do mm-hmm. in the transplant area makes it very difficult, I think.
I'm about to move to concluding statements, but yeah.
My name is Ravi Kuria. I am not on the provider side. I'm actually kind of more on the health insurance consulting side. I wanted to kind of go back to the healthcare cost item if we have a minute. While I agree it shouldn't necessarily change the decision on whether a patient should get a transplant or not, I do think that there's some sort of responsibility of a provider to educate the patient of, you know, what is the cost of this going to look like? And I think this example is a little bit easier to kind of showcase that than case one, where patient probably would be able to pay for the cost long term. But, you know, in this case, you know, even if the patient doesn't have insurance, even if the hospital ends up footing most of the bill, I mean, that patient's still going to have that hospital debt with them the rest of their life, potentially, right? And, you know, is there a responsibility of the provider to kind of educate the patient about that kind of cost piece, especially in end-of-life cases, which, you know, I think was discussed earlier in this course of, you know, those tend to be a higher cost and potentially waste areas in healthcare where, you know, maybe we're providing more treatment than absolutely necessary. I guess my question is, you know, is there a responsibility on the providers to have that discussion with their patients? Hey, you know, even after the surgery, you know, this is a huge cost, and, you know, especially as an uninsured patient, you know, I guess, do you need to let them know that, like, hey, this is going to live with you the rest of your life?
And can you even tell? Are you able to estimate the cost?
Well, I was just going to ask the question is, if you tell a patient or the surrogate decision maker the cost, how might that impact their own decisions about what to do? So I will give you a case of a situation that I've heard of where somebody was uninsured in a bad accident, was quadriplegic, but had decision-making capacity. And because they had no insurance and they were not going to be able to get insurance, the cost would be exorbitant to continue this patient on. They would need a ventilator. And so they asked the patient and who consulted with the family about, do you want us to remove the ventilator or not remove the ventilator? And how can you know whether or not the extreme costs that were laid out to the patient and the family, how that impacted their decision?
But could you argue that if you don't tell them that information, then they can't make a truly informed decision?
I think they should know, right? Yeah. I mean, the finances, in our healthcare system, it changes your life, right? Like, if you're stuck with some of these medical bills, especially if you don't have insurance, it's really, I mean, your quality of life after the procedure, from a financial perspective, is going to change. I would argue, if I was a patient, I would want to know kind of that impact.
So I think we see this play out in many different ways each and every day. And in fact, people, at least people dying of cancer, even those who are insured, the majority of them struggle with their bills, some more than others. And so many families are left impoverished. And so I think it's a sad fact that people sometimes do make decisions on terminating certain treatments so that there can be support left for their living family members. And so I think it's an issue that societally we need to grapple with, because I don't think we have any good answers right now. But I think it is something appropriate to discuss.
But I don't know whether that's necessarily the role of the physician. Mm-hmm. And that's, I think it's incredibly important. I think certainly in transplant, there are financial people who sit down and lay out the cost to patients so that they know what to expect. And there are times that, you know, patients have determined that they cannot afford or a transplant. But I think to put that, I think we have to be aware of the ramifications of what we do. So for example, I mean, I'm a cardiologist, so I could put someone on an Impella, which is $25,000 device, short term. Okay, that doesn't work. I could then put them on a Centromag, another medium term device that's $45,000. And then from that, I could then put them on an LVAD, which is $160,000, all in the same hospitalization. The hospital will get reimbursed for one of those. And then maybe down the road they'll get a transplant. That's a $1.3 million hospitalization, right? So if I am aware of all of those and I foresee the fact that I think he's going to need one durable LVAD, meaning one he could go home with, live for a while, maybe I don't do the interim things.
And I think that we have to be aware of the additive costs, not only to our system, to the hospital and the factor of reimbursement, but just it's a waste of money. Or if I'm going to be putting an LVAD in someone and they don't have a defibrillator, well, they probably don't need one if they have an LVAD. So I don't need to put in a $45,000 defibrillator if I'm going to put in a $160,000 LVAD. So I think that's the type of cost that we need to be aware of. But I don't think it's my role for some of the points that you mentioned to sit down with a family and say, you know, do you want to incur these costs? I think it's fair for me to say, you know, listen, you've got, you know, a really, really nice computer and you're telling me you can't pay for your medicines. This perhaps is not the wisest choice you're making on a sort of on a very detailed micro level, but not on a big level. Saying the choices you're making to buy your latte at Starbucks versus paying your $4 copay at Target, maybe not the best choice for you. That's where I think a physician should talk about costs with patients. But I don't think the bigger one, I think that will muddy the waters.
I personally do talk about that. But I think that it's in some cases it's impossible to talk about because we don't even know what the costs are gonna be, you know. But I think that there are, you know, for instance, transplant's very hard because this is almost an all or nothing game. This patient's either gonna get a transplant and ostensibly recover or is gonna die. So it's really hard to put a cost for on that, and especially if you work in this environment, you don't know what the costs are. But we do see a lot of patients who are maybe getting a second or third opinion for advanced cancer where you know that there is no cure. And I think that an advice from a physician at that moment to say, you know, be careful about going to an ER, you know, where they might do the same exact workup. I think that that can save people's families a lot of grief. And so, if I foresee something like that, then I think that it is my responsibility. So that's how I take it.
But loosely, I mean, generically, right, a right. warning as opposed to
generically,
down.
I don't sit down and go through. But I do think that's. We're in an environment where that is now should be on the table for, you know, like the holistic care of a patient.
So just recognizing we're short on time, hoping that, are there any more questions or comments from the audience? Yeah.
Sorry.
No.
This is kind of big picture general, and I waited until the end. I intentionally didn't ask this at the beginning because I wanted to hear kind of the shades of gray. But just being unfamiliar with the policy space in end-of-life care and mm-hmm. ethical decision-making, can you kind of paint big picture, rough outline, rough algorithm of kind of what policies and steps providers generally take when they're making these tough medical ethical decisions?
I actually think that's a great... See, I was going to move into final concluding thoughts, and I think the way you framed it is actually a way to serve as final concluding thoughts. So I'm curious if the folks at the table might... be willing to do that.
Do you want to start?
Now I want to start down there. I've been talking a lot.
One thing that I was going to say, and I think your framework of what's the big picture and how do things sort of filter down and how we address end-of-life care issues in an ethically appropriate manner following policies. There are just so many levels, and so I mean, at the federal level, for example, funding for big picture things like Medicare, palliative care, so that informs what healthcare professionals do at the bedside. If we're paid for having the conversations by Medicare, more health professionals are having those conversations about end-of-life care because that is relatively new. That came with the Affordable Care Act. And then at the next level, the state level, we are following the Advanced Directives Act in our practices at the bedside. And when there's conflict in end-of-life care, we go through the ethics pathway. So that's at the state level. Then on the actual local or institutional level, every institution implements policy at a different level, and so I would say some policies can be actually more restrictive. So for example, the policy that people have referred to the state through TADA, if there's conflict at end of life care, I think Dr. Winslade mentioned this, that you can have an ethics committee meet and decide if you agree with the patient or the surrogate decision maker versus the healthcare team, and then you follow whichever direction the ethics committee decides. At the hospital level, we've sort of added an extra layer. So not only can it be another physician, for example, it's a specific group of people who come together to make that decision. And then, again, so all those different levels. And then there are court decisions, the other thing I was going to ask or mention, that help determine implementation of policy. So
Joey's given us a very comprehensive snapshot. I think, you know, you can see that these are all complex and multi-layered things, and so I think it's hard to have fidelity to every layer at one time. You know, at one time, I can be my patient's advocate, I can steward my institutional resources, I can follow a policy. And so you can see that it gets challenging because they can't all be first priority at the same time. What I would like to add to Joey is that we need evidence-based approach, so science for all of these policies and procedures and guidelines. We need to recognize that there's a human aspect that complements the science so that it's not rigid. We need to have conversations with one another and with our healthcare team on a regular and ongoing basis and not wait until something drastic happens. Because even with the new Affordable Health Care Act, people still aren't doing it. And then last but not least, I think that all of us as members of the human community can advocate for the evidence base to develop and for people to have these conversations.
Do you all read comic strips like Dilbert and Pearls Before Swine, the only two I read in the Houston Chronicle? If the rat and the pig were talking about this guy's drinking problem, the rat would probably say, well, if he stopped drinking, he'd be a clean liver. Sorry, I've been restraining myself all night. I had to say it.
Any other comments?
Well,
I'm not sure I can follow that one entirely. You asked for the broad overview and summary. I think the principle first comes down to physicians. Their first obligation is their professional responsibility as a professional, which is based, going back well over 150 years, on the ethical principles set forth by our professional associations. But since my spin or take up here is this interaction with the professional organizations, I think at one point it is, and I talk primarily to the professional physician audience, we live in a free society, and we like to make fun of, you know, political jokes and its humor, but there's an inherent beauty to the way we collectively make decisions in this country as a democracy. And we as physicians owe a responsibility not only individually as a physician to that patient and behave on ethical framework that we've developed, but we also have a responsibility to participate in this society. And collectively, we speak through our professional organizations. And the professional organizations come up with their policy through a very similar democratic method that requires collective input on all physicians and does ultimately mean a majority vote to make a policy. But that's how we as physicians interact with our society based upon these policies, and that's where our influence on these laws come from. And even if they're not ideal laws, if we're not there at the table acting not just for our profession but the patients we serve, then very bad laws will be made. And if we are there,
There may still be bad laws, but at least it's done with the input of thoughtful professions acting both for ourselves and our patients in a way that represents our profession. And so it's that collective effort, I think, that's important to recognize as we talk about the global system we live in.
I mean, I think everybody's laid it out pretty well, but I think this is not a policy, but if you're in a situation with you know, you're taking care of a patient, what kind of care would you want if you were in that position? And then you try to provide that care, and when policy gets in the way, you fight against the policy, or you question the policy, or you make sure that you're interpreting the policy well, you know. And I actually think that the policies don't restrict that as much as the interpretation that we assign to that restrict it. So I'll just say that.
You got about 30 seconds. Anything else you want to add?
To sum up, I think what people have said here is that we have a professional responsibility to be active for our patients, for our profession. We have professional responsibility to be true to our own ethics as well as societal ethics and norms. And we need to have more conversations.
And I think we underscored the importance of professional organizations, all professional organizations, interacting with federal and state law as well as ethical norms. We highlighted a lot of ethical considerations. It's complicated, but we hope that the framework we gave you towards the end gives at least a few guideposts and recognize that these cases in and of themselves are complex and multifaceted, and it's really hard to create black and white rules. But we tried to some extent.
I'd like to say something about the way in which you handled both the panel and the audience,
because it was really...
Oh, thank you. Thank you.